My farm needs the earth, the air, and the water. I get my energy going on LMNT Electrolyte Drink Mix. Clean, good-tasting energy that feeds me like I feed my plants and animals. And after a long day on the tractor, when it's time to shoot the podcast, I drink LMNT so that I can stay energized and stay salty. Let's get it on. Well, we are lucky enough now to be in the presence of the pound-for-pound best fighter in the world, the lightweight champion of the UFC, a man who has just been on fire throughout his career, a guy that everybody was avoiding until now he's the champ, and everybody is now, oh, I want him. Islam Makhachev, what is up, my man? You're looking good.
What's up, guys? Good to see you.
Good to see you.
So I guess we'll get started with, you know, the easiest questions. You know, how was camp? How have you been
feeling? Easy questions.
Those are the easy questions. How was camp and how you been feeling, my man?
Good. We went to the New Jersey 3 weeks before the fight. Mm-hmm. Now in New Jersey, rent some big house. We're training in Nick Caton MMA.
Yep.
We have very good gym.
Nick Caton is a great guy.
Yeah, Nick Caton, yeah. Very good gym, like two cage mats, like everything for the camp, you know. I bring a lot of guys with me to the sparring, and coach Khabib come after a couple days. Everybody here.
Everybody's here. Did you reflect on some of your Khabib's fight with him, with Dustin, and then go back and watch that tape? I know he's grown a lot since that fight, but I mean, there's a lot of similarities. He hasn't changed a whole lot, though, either.
Honestly, if I want to finish Dustin, I don't have to change something. I have to follow same plan, you know, because Dustin in the weak point, the wrestling, grappling, he have always problem is the guy who have good wrestling, good grappling. That's why I will follow same plan. I will finish him in the ground. But I can striking with him. I can kick him. Like, I can play with him, you know.
Yeah, but he can kick you back.
It's no problem, man.
It's no problem. Let me ask you about your camp. When, you know, you've been at Nick Caton's now, as far as, you know, this training camp and stuff. What's the difference when Khabib ends up showing up? Do you see everyone kind of changing their attitudes, changing their intensity?
Yeah, when Khabib is here, it's more hard because, you know, when I go to the cage with the opponents, some of the guys, like today, I did two rounds with Usman, two rounds with other guy, Amru. They want to, you know, looking good in front of Khabib, and they give me more hard time, you know. That's why it's, and the training, you know, because, Josh, you remember when we trained, we did sparring in the big room, we go to the cage, and we go like three rounds, we do some grappling or something after that. Yeah. But this guy now, I don't know, I ask him, hey, when we training together, we never do this. And after the sparring, we do 10 rounds grappling. We do some drills, you know, like more than 2 hours training.
Is that so? That's when Khabib is there, right?
Yeah. I don't remember when we were together, we're training like that.
No, brother, do you remember, though, that wrestling practice was really easy when DC was wrestling? But when DC didn't have a fight, it was 2 hours long and very hard because he wasn't training.
Same thing is here, man. And I asked Javier, hey, coach, can you stop these guys? You older than him. You the head coach. He said, no, you have to listen, Javier. And every coach said, listen to him. I don't like this, honestly.
What is it like to have, like, you have Usman, you know, and he's the champ over at Bellator. You guys are both at 155 pounds. You know, you've known him for a long time, you know, coming up, him and his brother, Umar. What's it like, though, having somebody like your size that can give you different looks? You know, I mean, on the feet, he's really good, really crafty, you know, but he's getting a lot better on the ground, and his wrestling's come a long way.
Yeah, Usman honestly always gave me good rounds. He just, you know, after he was sick, and he just come like 2 days ago. We are 1 week here. He, when he feel like better, right away he come to support me, and today he give me two good rounds, you know. This guy have, I think, better striking than Dustin. He give me good time in the in the striking because, you know, his kick, his arm, he's really good in the striking, honestly. And, you know, when you spar with the some guy with the high level, it's, you know, what they call like sharp iron make.
Iron sharpens iron. Iron.
Yeah, iron sharpens iron.
Jump. Iron also breaks iron, so you got to be careful about how hard you
yeah,
do go.
Yeah, you have to be careful, honestly, yes, yeah. Because when you cut weight, it's injury can happen easier. But we control, you know, we know each other. I don't like when I have like last month to spar with some new guys because they can give you injury, they can give you some, mm-hmm. like, they can give you some, I don't know, with whatever you... You're not waiting for, they can give you something and make you injured, you know. Mm-hmm. But the old team, I spar all my life. And I bring here Usman. I have Amru, he's a YA Warrior champion. I have Zainuko, he's a two-time Muay Thai world champion. I have Sagid, he's a one championships fighter. Mamedo, I have like five guys I have in my weight class, you know. I think high level guys.
I saw one of your past interviews with DC, and you were saying that you have something special because every time Dustin gets taken down, he gives his back or he gets choked. But you have a different type of submission, different type of choke for him. I know you're not going to elaborate too much because it's a surprise. But
hello,
you know my grind game. Yeah. I can give him some surprise. You know,
I know you're.
If I tell you now, no. He will prepare. You know, that's why this have to be secret.
You gotta figure. Josh is gonna ask you to give away the secret technique that you're gonna use.
Because
that is that's a Josh Thompson question.
Almost everything because I give him in the cage.
Oh, not everything. I used to give a lot of back. I used to give a lot back. Let's not be mistaken. Come on, a couple takedowns here and there, a couple hip toss, foot sweep.
Brother, you're still looking good, looking shape. You know, you have to come to New Jersey, give me a couple of rounds, working, do something.
I might be able to give you 2.5 minutes. That's about it.
I was thinking maybe 45 seconds and it's going to really taper off.
No, this guy, I think, always eat clean and looking good, you know.
I try.
So let me ask you this, though. You won the title from Charles. You're only two defenses. You have the same guy. Does it feel good? Actually being able to prepare for
doesn't
somebody.
Doesn't feel not good. I don't like the rematch, you know. That's why I want to beat some new guy.
That's what I'm saying. It feels good to be able to prepare for someone other than Alexander Volkanovski.
Yeah, honestly, it's, yeah. But last camp, I don't prepare for the Volkanovski. I prepare for Olivera. Charles, but yeah. But after this fight, I have one more guy who I beat already, you know, Arman.
Mm-hmm.
What about Arman? How do what? Look, he has been absolutely looking great.
Yeah.
And you had a good fight with him already. You got the win. But what do you think are the improvements that you've seen out of Armin that makes him now at the point where he deserves that title fight?
For sure he deserved the title fight. He beat everybody who we have in the lightweight. But it's going to be same, you know. I don't see something he have more than me, honestly. Wrestling or grappling or striking, he have same. He will be one day champion maybe when I retired, but now we're in the different level.
I told everybody when you fought Charles that you were going to be able to take him down and dominate, and everyone was like, oh, he's the number one submission guy in the UFC. I said, wait till he gets on top of him. I said, look for Kimura or look for the side choke, and sure enough, jumped right to the side choke. But when you look at someone like Dustin, right, Dustin will put himself in jeopardy by jumping guillotine. And if you, in all fairness, he was probably the closest one to ever finishing Habib, and it was with that guillotine. So have you guys been practicing? Have you been working? Have you guys been really considering that, given that that was one thing that Habib had to kind of watch out for in that fight?
For sure, we pay attention for this, which I did yesterday, the drills, and I give my neck, and I have pain now, you know. I don't want to give him more because yeah, we did practice because he have very good guillotine. He never finished someone in the fight, but if he jump all the time and he believe his guillotine, it's mean he have not bad guillotine. That's why I will prepare. You know, I have to pay attention for this for sure.
Yeah, you can't be silly. He'll jump the ghillie. That's the way we look at it.
But this is the bad luck for him, because always he jumped to the guillotine and he have some trouble.
With your ability to hold people down, control the top position, and I mean, like I said, I know your game. It's that, you know, you have the good back control, good at giving heavy pressure. In this situation, are you going to be chasing the submissions looking for this, or is it kind of whatever he presents with your ground and pound? Because people don't, when they talked about you, they talk about your wrestling and your jiu-jitsu. And I've talked a lot about your jiu-jitsu because I know how good your grappling is. But they haven't seen your ground and pound yet. Like I don't think people understand your ground and pound is almost as dominant as Habib's. You tend to slowly, methodically work towards the submission. Are we going to see more of the ground and pound in this fight?
You know, because Josh, I don't know, because maybe I like the submission. When I take down somebody, I always looking for some space to do some submission. If I focus in the ground and pound, I have to, like, you know, change. First, I have to give some ground and pound because, and I have more space to give some submission. But I don't know, last my opponents, when I take them down, like, right away, I have something to do, you know, for, like, Oliveira. I, like, put my arm to the neck and I feel if I close my arm, I can finish him, you know, and just what I did. But with the Volkanovski, like the first fight, you know, when I catch his back and I feel I don't have the power to finish him because I'm not recovering very well after the weigh-in, you know, in this fight, honestly, it's many, many things what I cannot do because I don't feel my power bring back, you know.
When you take a look at, you know, the way that you've developed, though, one of the things that people do not give you credit for is your stand-up. And Josh, all the time we talk about it, you know, yeah, you're known as a grappler, but your stand-up has become very, very good. And, you know, your ability to launch that left hand down the pipe, the way you set up your left high kick, who is it that you would give credit to for giving you the most as far as changing the way that you... That's going to be Josh. The way that you have now developed. Is it Javier? Is it some of your sparring partners? Who is it?
Honestly, you know, all my life I striking with the high-level guys, you know. But I always choose the easy way because I know I have more than, like, I am good in the wrestling. Like, I have more than skills in everybody. That's why I choose the wrestling. But, like, honestly, for the kick, high kick, like all my life, I kick a lot and I landed many kicks left side. But and I thinking when it's landed in the fight, you know, and the last fight when they landed, I was so happy because many time I landed in the gym, like in the amateur my career, I have couple knockouts from the left kick. But when this landed in the fight, I was very happy.
I spent a lot of time in the early parts of when you were making your rise to the title. And I spent a lot of time talking about how people underestimated your stand-up because you had the one loss. And I was like, it was really, you just got clipped and got caught, you know, in the quick exchange. But in that take, though, I said, look, everyone kept thinking that you were like Khabib. I said, no, he is nothing like Khabib. You guys are completely different. In the cage, inside the practice room, on the wrestling, and even how you guys wrestle, everything is completely different, and everyone wants to make the comparison. What do you think sets you apart from what he does? I know you guys both have the same, you know, coach and his father, and then obviously with Javier. But you guys are completely different. And why did you guys become so different?
Islam, just tell him I'm just better. I'm just better.
I think Khabib have more like wrestling pressure. He like to go double leg, single leg. But I like to working from the clinch, you know. I did some sambo stuff, some judo stuff. Because I was, when I was young, I was loved judo. I did like a lot of sambo competition. I compete in the just Russian championship 10 times, you know. That's why I think we have a little bit different style, but the goal is same: take down people, hold them, make them tired, and finish, you know.
Well, you've both been very successful in doing that and doing it well, so the plan
because
is working.
Because we did this all life, you know. When we was beginning in our gym, nobody have the boxing gloves. Yeah. We just one thing. We go come to the gym and all day we wrestle. Wrestling and grappling. We don't have boxing gloves. You know, when the Khabib signed with the UFC and we beginning do some sparring, you know. But before we're all wrestlers. Wrestlers or judo or sambo.
When he came, I mean, we had to give him that headgear, and he still has that headgear.
Brother, headgear, I don't know. Maybe like 2 years ago, like we have in rules in the gym. Hey, guys, everybody have to buy the headgear.
Yes.
Because they protect from the
cuts.
From like many things. Mm-hmm. And now we have the rules in our gym. Everybody have to have headgear.
How easy is it,
brother?
Before
we don't have mouthpiece. Maybe we go some competition and we can use one mouthpiece.
One mouthpiece for everybody. I'm done. It's yours.
I remember.
This is true.
I remember.
Brother, I swear to God, I remember one competition. We have one mouthpiece for like 10 people. In the rules, you cannot go to the inside the fight without the mouthpiece. We clean,
true.
Put hot water, and everybody.
You didn't even put hot water on it. Don't lie.
You just dunked it in water.
You may have put a little water on it.
We put hot water because it's different, you know.
To try to change it.
Yeah, we will change a little bit.
Enough for it to stay in. Just
I've seen enough fighters.
But
walk
I'm
into,
surprised when I came to AKA. Josh put first some plastic mouthpiece. After he put like other one, I don't know what it is. I asked Josh.
So I have Invisalign, and so I would wear the bottom piece for Invisalign, and I'd wear my regular mouthpiece on the top, because I'd split my lip where my tooth came through on the bottom. So I split my lip here and here. So I wore a bottom one.
That's why you're looking so good now.
Beautiful.
You protect yourself.
Beautiful. This jawline cannot be forgotten. You guys know.
Josh, do you remember Carl Parisian?
Yes, I do remember Carl.
Two times I freaking refereed him. He walked in, didn't have a mouthpiece, took out the mouthpiece, the boil and bite, mm-hmm. that was unboiled and stuck it in his mouth and fought.
Well, we had a guy, Mike Kyle. You remember Mike Kyle? He would go, if he didn't have a mouthpiece, he'd go and wad up paper towel and put it in his mouth. And he would just and he would just bite on it when he sparred. That's what he would wear. He's like, I just don't want to get my tooth chipped from one clash into the other. I'm like, he's gonna get knocked out.
Yeah.
look, like John was saying, you fought Volkanovski both times. You know, you were supposed to fight Charles. There's been a mix up now because Justin Gaethje was supposed to probably be next. He loses to Armand, and then Charles, you know, goes on and loses as well.
He loses to Armand. He lost to Max.
Oh, sorry, to Max. Okay, sorry, my bad. So then these guys.
I apologize. No. He's getting a little bit. You see how he's what? No, I'm
getting
does
excited.
Right,
I think you don't follow the MMA. You don't follow UFC. What you did? Play golf?
No.
All
so
day?
Justin loses to Max, and then Armand beats Charles. So now there's a mix up, but now it's fresh guys for you. Obviously, there was a lot of talk of you going to fight Leon at 170, but now I just saw some comments you made about, no, you need to stay in your division. You need to clear out your division. Give me some more insight on your next couple opponents. You got Armand.
Honestly, who deserved the title fight? I have just Armand, because this guy have seven. How many fight win streak he beat? Like, tough guys. He is a number one in the rankings. And after him, I think... the all job is done in my division, because I don't know. I don't have any interesting fights, some excited fight, because they all beat each other. And after Armand, my plan to jump to the welterweight.
Okay. So now, even if Max was to not make the deal go through with Ilya Topuria,
Max have work in his division.
He does. I mean, but who is he working his division except for Topuria? I mean, he's pretty much cleared out that whole division.
Okay, if he beat Topuria, he have to defend his belt with Mosar. He have Mosar.
Okay. Yeah, with Mosar.
He's undefeated. Mm-hmm. Undefeated. How many fights he have win streak?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So he's got some.
I don't want to give the chance to the small guys. You know, no more.
Well, is it because you got so much flack for the Volkanovski fight? Is that what you're thinking?
Yeah, because I give already the chance, you know. I need my chance. I know it's going to be a very good fight with the Leon, because I know this guy. I know his skills. I already sparred with him in the AKA, remember?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How many years ago? But he improved. That time, he came to AKA to improve his wrestling, you know? Yeah. To become
Which
better.
He has done.
Yeah, for sure. Now he's, you know, he have everything. Wrestling, very good striking, clinch, everything, you know? That's why I think it's going to be a very good fight for me.
But then you say Leon, but then you know he's
Brother,
got
who
some...
this guy? He don't have question. He does. He just listen to us.
Yeah, he just produces this. He listens to us. Okay. He makes fun. He makes fun of me when I mess up.
He'll make funny faces though.
Yeah, he goes.
Yeah.
Okay. But then there's Leon there, but he's also got somebody waiting for that title shot in Bilal Muhammad, and Bilal deserves that title shot.
Yeah, for sure.
Absolutely.
And so I know
he'll fight. I think in Manchester very soon.
Okay.
July.
Now, what happens if Bilal beats him? Then what do you do?
Oh, look at the change of attitude there. Come on. Why?
Bilal, he was here now. Yes. He just came yesterday. I don't know, brother. I don't know. We have same manager. We will do something.
I don't blame you for not fighting Bilal. It's tough. You know, when you train with
so
people like
enough,
that, it's not easy.
Guy.
He's such a good guy. We had him on the show. Yes. He's been absolutely amazing. He is such a good person. He just
came to the camp, mm-hmm. and he was sparring today with Sagid. And, you know, he's going to be crazy fight mm-hmm. because Bilal waiting too much for his chance, and he training very hard for this moment.
Well, let me, you know, he's very similar in what you went through. You know, he's got all these wins. Well, you had the same thing. You had a giant win streak, and it always seemed that you were the one getting passed over for someone else to get the title shot. And finally, you got the title shot. You take it. You win it. What's the difference in your mentality now as far as being the guy that's looking at that target or now being the guy that is the target?
Before, man, I have crazy problem. For find some opponent, you know, from the top. I always call someone, but no one give me answer. You know,
I can tell you why.
I was like lucky because the problem is finished. You know, now somebody call my name, but before I don't remember when somebody call my name. You know, finally it's finished.
So do you like it this way? You like it when people are calling you out? Then does it make it like
yeah? Okay. I like when the top guys want to fight with me. You know?
I'm gonna throw something out there that we haven't brought up, and you didn't even bring it up, but we know how the UFC feels about Conor McGregor, and he's got that fight with Michael Chandler. I know that Armand is waiting there in the wings. Let's be honest. If he goes out there and looks great against Chandler, is that a likely fight for you?
Brother, I have to be stupid if so I say no. Of course, I will say yes. If I win the next fight, and when I will fight again, like October, November, before October, November, I can fight with him. In, I don't know, August, September, because this guy is not top level fighters, you know. For sure, he is he did very good in media, but his skills and he is not same, you know. Before he is a not bad fighter, he have good striking, very good left hand, but not now. He drinking too much. He is no more high level UFC fighter. He is a party guy, you know. Party, drinking, do all bullshit stuff.
Do you think it was the loss to Khabib that kind of put him, you know, and separated him from away from the sport? He started after that fight. He started kind of disconnecting.
When he just make like crazy money, he changed, you know. The drunk, the alcohol changed him. And I think very hard to come back for him, but I think finally Chandler fight with him. Because Chandler, how many years this guy wait, you know? He can fight 3-4 times, but he's still waiting.
In that fight, you're looking at you're saying that McGregor is not what he used to be, and is because of the partying and stuff, is not a UFC level fighter. Are you picking Michael Chandler in that fight?
Still, Conor can knock him out like first round, But if they go like more than one, two round, I think Chandler will beat him. Chandler have problem with the condition always, but you know, I think Chandler can beat him.
You think he gets it done on the ground? But he won't wrestle. Michael Chandler.
Yeah,
but we see. I don't know. Chandler fight like stupid sometimes. He go crazy always, you know.
See, that's our problem. Look, he's got good wrestling. He just doesn't use it. He just doesn't use it.
You know, but one thing, if he's smart, if he fights smart, win somebody, he never fight with Conor. He lose for purpose, and now they have chance, you know.
Yeah.
He go crazy. Give the fans what they like, and now he have chance to make good money. But you know, if he fights smart, he's a like high level guy, you know, because he have heavy punch, he have good wrestling, and he just have to be smart, you know.
Yeah.
When you look at your opponent Dustin, he's got good wrestling. He's very confident in his guillotine. He's got good power on the feet, and he's a southpaw.
Yeah.
You know, having to fight another southpaw because you're a southpaw yourself, he will switch a little bit here and there, but he prefers to stay in his southpaw stance. Do you notice that you have a little bit of an issue sometimes having to go against other southpaws? Because there's not a lot of them out there to really train with or to work with and that you fight.
Now I have a couple of the guys with the southpaw. And before I have opponent like Drew Dober. Mm-hmm. He is the same. He have heavy punch, you know. He stay in southpaw. And I have some experience with the southpaw, you know.
Yeah.
To the wrestler, I think southpaw world is southpaw more comfortable. The stance is more comfortable because you can go single leg, you can go double leg. Mm-hmm. But when you go double leg, you have to be careful about the Dustin choke.
The guillotine.
Jump in the ghillie.
But, you know, honestly, Dustin is a good fighter, you know, high level. He beat, like, many guys. He all his career he in the high level fighting with the top, you know. That's why I have to be ready because this guy can give me a hard time, you know. I prepare myself for the hard five round.
I don't blame you.
I have to be stupid to underestimate him because, you know, this guy can knock out everybody.
When you take a look at the people that are in the rankings as far as your lightweight division, you get past, we'll say, this fight with Dustin, we'll say you get past Arman Tsarukyan. Have you thought about someone like Gamrot, who's there, a very good wrestler, a guy who still is getting those wins, and you're saying you've wiped out the division? There's a guy that you have not faced.
Gamrot also is very good, but this guy need a couple more fights because before the title fight, I have 10 fight win streak, you know.
And he's coming off a loss.
Long way, yeah. This guy have lost.
He's not coming off a loss. What are you talking about? Have you lost your mind?
I thought he just Gamrot
lost with the.
He just won his last fight.
Yeah, not last fight. Last fight he beat the guy. But Dariush beat him.
Yes.
Yes.
When you're taking a look at these guys that are there, I mean, you've got guys like Brandon Allen. You've got other guys that are in that mix. Sorry, not Brandon Allen, but you've got – I keep going. Mess
it up. No, 185.
Come on.
He's throwing you into the middleweight mix now, man.
It would be – not Brandon Allen. Gosh, anyways. Okay. I was thinking Gamrot also, but then Gamrot, and then you got Dariush. But you were supposed to fight Dariush. And Dariush is still in that kind of that mix a little bit, but then you've got Gamrot with the wrestling.
Dariush have two fights, people knock him out.
You're right.
He's have the long way for the title fight, I think.
And then what about someone like a Justin Gaethje? Because like he's kind of in a Dustin Poirier position where he beat Dustin, and then now he lost, but then he's only lost to the top guys. I mean, do you still consider that after an
Armand? I don't know. You know, like for example. What Dustin have now? Just one fight win streak. It can happen because in the top five in my division, everybody beat each other. But champion have to defend the belt, and someone can be next, you know. But I know
Someone can come get it.
Yeah, Arman for sure is gonna be next, and after this fight, I will ask about the welterweight.
So when you take a look at your career, do you have almost like, you know, Habib had, he had an idea of where he wanted to get to and where his exit was at. It kind of got, you know, accelerated based upon the passing of his father. But have you thought about it? Have you looked at it, or you're just far away from that at your age?
I don't know. No, I don't think about the retired because I have some deal, you know. I want to take the second belt, defend my lightweight belt. And I still feel good, you know. When I feel I lose someone, I'm not same, and I will thinking about it. But right now, I'm still young, still hungry, still want to be number one.
Perfect.
In the when you jump up to the say you up to welterweight, Bilal, you know, he comes up short and you fight Leon. I mean, are you looking to stay in that division for a while, not dropping back down to 55? This won't be a one shot thing.
Maybe we'll see, because I don't like the cut weight. Like right now, I'm diet. Maybe welterweight it's gonna be easy, because you know the cut weight stuff I always hate. But all my life I cutting weight, you know.
Is it? Are you the person that does the bath and then the towels and the bath and the towels? Are you?
No, bath I don't like. Bath I never use.
So you use the
last
sauna?
Last time I don't use sauna. I just did like I wake up 5 in the morning, 9 a.m. we have rain. I did running, meets, bike, something like this. Yeah. But sauna is good sometimes. With the sauna, which one your head outside, you know? That one I like.
The one you can actually breathe decent temperature air. Yeah, I don't
but
blame you.
The other one, it's I don't like. Some of them like, you know, sit the big sauna, but I hate this. When you cut weight, your head have to be outside, you know, and you have to breathing, you know. But bath, I don't like. I try to do one time. It's very bad, you know.
So I saw that Habib has his school. I think it's right there in his town, and it's the Nurmagomedov school, correct?
Yeah.
I noticed that there's a lot of young, new talent that you guys have out of there, but you guys have a huge kids program that he is developing. Yeah. There's tons of kids in there.
The problem, man. The old gym is full. Every section full. Like we don't have some space, but new people coming, always want to training in our gym. Maybe Habib have to. We have two now, but two is full. We have to open some new one.
And where is this gym at? Where is it located at?
In the downtown Makhachkala, our city.
Okay. And then how far is that from your house? Because you and Habib live separately, right? He lives.
Yeah. Before we live same area, 2 minutes in between. But now I live in the I live in the Makhachkala, but other side where they not. Big building, sleep area, New Jersey, you know. New Jersey don't have big building, you know.
Yeah.
And I living there. But Habib's still living in downtown.
In downtown with all the big buildings.
Yeah.
That's good.
And Habib spent a lot of time in his village. His village, 1 hour from the Makhachkala.
Yeah.
He built, big house there. He spent a lot of time there. The Usman, Omar, Abu Bakr, everybody from this village. They have enough sparring partner in the village too. Yeah.
I noticed that there's another one of your guys' teammates who made the move over to Nurmagomedov school is Magomed Magomedov. So he fights this weekend against Patchy Mix, who was really good grappler. I consider him to be the best 135 pounder in the world. What changes have you seen out of Magomed Magomedov since training over at Habib school?
You know, I think most high level guys, which one we have 135, Omar division, and 155 in our gym. And when Magomed joined to the team, he have very good sparring partners there, high level. We don't know guys, some of the guys which one I call, have Rinat Khawalov, he the other organization champion, Omar. Magomed Magomedov, we have amateur guy, he's a world champion, amateur, you know, a lot of guys, and give each other very hard time, you know, and I think Magomed improved a lot in our gym, he improved grappling for sure, because first time he lost by guillotine. Now I think he working on his grappling. And the second fight is going to be very good.
When you look at that, when you look at their first fight and you see this fight here, I mean, John and I have talked about it. I think that, honestly, just he's wrestling so good, but avoiding the takedowns, avoiding the clinch, utilizing his striking, which is very underrated as well. I mean, he was the first guy to beat Peter Yan, and Peter Yan was a beast coming up, somebody that everyone was just thought was unbeatable until he got beat. But you look at Magomedov, he's got the spinning attacks. He's really long for the size at 135 pounds. How does he utilize his stand-up to keep that range and that distance away from someone like Apache Mix?
I think Patrick's have like best grappling in 135 in the world. But maybe Magomed underestimated his grappling, and I don't understand why he tried to take him down. He have to stay in the stand-up and striking with him, because I know he have better striking. That's why I know now he changed his plan to the fight, and I don't think he will make same mistake, you know.
What makes you think that Patchy Mix has the best grappling in the world at 135? Have you trained with him? Have you seen him training?
Yeah, I trained with him. Yeah. I did like a couple of grappling match, and this guy, if he catch someone back, you know, he can finish everybody. He have very good choke from the back. He always try to catch the back, and the skills. I saw his grappling in the UFCPI when he grappling with the small guy. Mm-hmm. Oh, he always choke someone, you know.
He's good at it.
Honestly, he's very good. Not like very good. Some, like I say, like for like other people, this guy know like ground game very, very well.
Absolutely, we talk about him all the time, and he doesn't believe that he gets the recognition that he deserves. You know, if you compare him to Sean O'Malley, they're very close as far as records. Yeah. You know, as far as how many fights they've had, they both have one loss. Patchy was like, I want to say he was like 11-0 as an amateur also, but he looks at it like, you know, I don't get the respect that Sean O'Malley gets based upon where he's fighting at and stuff. But
Sean O'Malley also, he can beat everybody. Like same style have Aljo, but Sean O'Malley beat him, you know, same style. If Aljo take someone the back, it's always give trouble. But Sean, his defense and knock him out, you know. So this guy can knock out anyone.
One more from me on the matchups is you got Umar. He's fighting Corey Sandhagen.
That's what I was going to ask.
Corey is a dog on the feet. He's gotten really good at, you know, he being crafty on the ground himself. Obviously, I don't want you to give away game plans, but I'm like, how does Umar deal with?
No, you
with
just
this?
Asked him to tell the technique that he's going to end the fight against Dustin with, but you're not asking about game
plans.
No,
I'm not.
You know, Corey Sandhagen, one of the smart guy in division, I think. You know,
yep.
You know what he, you know his weak point. He improved like last fight. What he did, he like tried, because in last fight he prepared for the Umar, but Umar pulled out. He was sick, and he improved his wrestling a lot. You know, but Umar is very hungry. This guy is like training every day. He was in the camp with us in the mountain, and he prepared himself for the August. He not with us now, because he's still training in Makhachkala. I told you guys we have a lot of guys, 135 high level guys, and you know, it's biggest chance for Umar to beat this guy, fight for the title, and to be number one. But Corey, I like his style. His how he relax in the fight, you know, how he move. He's very good, you know. And number one, he's a smart guy.
Yeah, he's very smart. Good, he's very technical.
Good fight IQ.
Yeah. All right, so I'm gonna get you out of here on this. Give me your prediction, obviously, on your fight.
That's what I
first round submission, second round submission, distance. What you think? Knockout? Are we gonna look for? Are you gonna look for the head kick knockout? Have you fallen in love with your power now? Is that what we're gonna see?
Brother, I don't know how, but inside the 3 round, I will finish Dustin. I will try every second. I look for the finish always.
Good.
Sounds good to me. Islam, we want to thank you for coming on the show. Best of luck in your matchup against Dustin Poirier in a couple weeks. You are an absolute savage when it comes to the fight world, but you represent the sport of MMA beautifully. I want to thank you for that. You're an absolute gentleman, and I every time I see you with people, you're fantastic. So thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, guys.
I wanted to say the same thing as you and Habib and all of your guys, like Umar, Usman, you guys handle yourself with class, man. And it gives the young kids something to look up to. My son talks about you all the time now, always asks when you're going to fight now. And he asked about Habib too, and he even asked about Umar. So
thank you, Josh. It means a lot. You always help us a lot. I remember. Thank you,
brother. Oh, and the other thing, that you buying Alexander Volkanovsky's little girl's toys after she was afraid that you were going to come.
Yeah, because I'm not bad guy, you know.
No. Wonderful.
I never come from the window somehow house because she has to think good about me. I know I'm not bad guy.
That's awesome. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show. Ladies and gentlemen, the pound for pound best, Mr. Islam Makhachev.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Good to see you, folks.